That's right. It's Tuesday night. Sports on the Hill podcast, True Radio Network, CP3 coming to you live from the lab. You just saw the results of game three, the highlights of that great game. And unfortunately, we're going to have to break down game four. Have a lot of conflicted opinions about this game, and I'm going to talk about my opinions. Rob is going to get his. And as you see, Anna Kay already is on the screen, and I know she has her opinion about the game also. But we're also going to talk some Mets baseball. They currently are down to the Mets 3-2. They just gave up the lead in the bottom of the sixth. They were up 2-0. Gave up three runs to their relief pitcher, Patrick Corbin. Had five innings of scoreless pitching. And that was one of his better performances of the season. Unfortunately, the bullpen gave up the lead, so he won't be earning his first victory of the season. We'll be breaking down the 2-4 week and talk about the 4-5 road trip. Excuse me, that the Nets just came off. And then we'll be talking about the series with the Mets that they're currently in now. Excuse me. And we'll have the NBA semifinal recap with Robbie, and I believe Brian will be joining the show. So as always, we have a full show breaking all of this stuff down, playoff edition. Robbie G, how you doing tonight, good sir?
Good, yeah, it's a busy night here. I was just out to dinner with my mom. It's her birthday on Thursday, so we're celebrating a little bit early and a little belated Mother's Day since she just flew back from her awesome dive trip to around the world, and so it was nice to be able to catch her between two trips and celebrate with her and my dad, and my mother-in-law is here, and both my kids were there, and we went to our favorite Italian restaurant where I've gone there for 30 years, and I used to actually work there as their webmaster a long time ago, but we had a great dinner, and it's been an up and down week, as you were starting to talk about. I think any of us would have taken 500, win two, lose two, if we were given the option last week. I was just praying that we would have some more Caps hockey to talk about last week. I was nervous with the juggernaut team that was we were facing. We could get swept, but we talked about it. I thought we could win one. I was hoping for two. Three was going to be the long shot. We almost got three though, which is pretty incredible how it's a game of inches, right? We'll talk about that game more in depth, but we were an inch away from taking a 3-1 lead, a commanding lead in this series. Although we'll talk about in the past, we've had 3-1 series leads and it not been successful for us. And in fact, overall, we do better when we're coming from behind in a series or the series is tied 2-2, which I know would surprise a lot of people. But if they remember on the 2018 run, the only time that we were up 3-1 in a series was that last round. So, it was the previous three rounds, we were never up so big. There's a lot of work to be done. We'll break it all down. We'll also talk about this live Nats game. Also, the Mystics just won. I was watching that game just now. So we'll talk about the beginning of their season towards the end of the podcast. And we'll talk about this Nats game again. They're down 3-2 to the Mets right now, but we'll talk about their week with Carol and Brian. And then Brian and I will also discuss this very exciting NBA round two of the playoffs. We'll break down all the series as well. But I'm going to get Anna's initial thoughts. We didn't get to see you last week to preview this series, but how are you doing? And then we'll get into the first game after that.
I'm doing good. I'm doing good. Happy Tuesday, guys.
Yeah, it's weird to do it on a Tuesday. It's a strange thing. Yeah, I'm happy we didn't try to compete with the game last night. I could not have done that. I
can multitask kind of, but when it comes to that, I think I would have been very distracted. It would have been very annoying to listen to or watch. But yeah, all good. All good on this end. Had a great Mother's Day and glad that you guys both did as well with your families.
Happy belated Mother's Day.
Thank you. Weather was fantastic for grilling on Sunday, which I know Carol can relate to, and it was good. So still a little a little perturbed about last night's game, but I don't know. I know you guys are going back and forth in the chat a lot, and I think I just was sort of sitting like
he sat back a little bit. Yeah, you didn't know where to, and I didn't blame you. I wouldn't give a TV.
It's like I just kind of had to sit there and think, like, listening to both sides, and I thought, God, I'm torn, you know, because usually I've got like such an opinion and stuff like that, but I know we can get to that after we talk about at least the first two games.
Yeah, let's just break down the game one, and then we'll get Carol's thoughts, and then I'll give my thoughts on it.
All right, so May 3rd, wow, here we go, kicking off the first game in Florida, and here, 3:47, Tommy Wilson scores a power play goal, assisted by Mantha and Schultz, followed by a Panthers goal at 7:55, and I hate to say that that's kind of the only time we're going to hear about Wilson, and that breaks my heart, but okay. Second period, Claude Giroux scores the only goal in the second. Third period, Caps dominated. So that's all we care about. Kuzi scores at 8:14, assisted by Ovi and Oshie. Assisted by Ovi, and then Oshie with a tip in at 10:37, and an empty netter by the Tiger at 19:11 with a 4-2 win. And this was Vitek Vanacek's chance to shine, and he did. I thought he just kicked ass in this game, and I thought this was like exactly how the Capitals need to kick off the series. So this game I loved. I thought it was, you know, minus of course, you know, Tommy leaving and Gudas being a bitch and everything else, but overall it was a great way to kick off the series, especially in Florida.
Yeah, Carol, what were some of your thoughts on game one?
I definitely agree. this was the battle of the best home team and the best road team. The Capitals came out with a game plan. They executed. Double V was locked in for the most part. They were effective 200 foot. They played a 200 foot game. They slowed them down in the neutral zone. They took away their strengths. They hit them, even though they did get out hit that game. But they hit them, they were more physical. And unfortunately, even losing Tommy, it did suck to lose him, but it was good to see the team still stay together, even though the lines had got switched up and, you know, things weren't going according as, you know, scripted, but they still got the victory on the road. It was a great team victory. And I was hoping that it would carry the momentum into game two, that they would be able to maybe steal two in Florida. Robbie talked about having a 3-1 lead and Nevada has a farewell for him. And to me, that means absolutely nothing. The past is the past. Different team, different players, different coach. You know, you can think about that stuff, you know, you can talk about it, but honestly, that's nothing we will go over on ice year in, year out, playoffs, different every year, different teams, different process. And so it was just a good way to kick off the series and show Florida that even though the Caps are the eighth seed and only have 22 points behind them, the President's Trophy winners, that they can still handle their business and still beat them as long as they play their game. And that's what they did that first game.
Yeah, I'll add that I agree that every playoff series is different, but there just seems to be these demons that are lingering. And I don't know if it's just in the Caps fans' minds and hearts and had nothing to do with what actually happens on the ice. But like, I feel like I've seen certain scenarios over and over again through Caps history. And it's frustrating because different coaches, different players, different everything. And I feel like I see some of the same storylines get rewritten. And I'm happy in 2018 that a lot of those stories, you know, were written differently that year, but it hasn't been proven to me that that is something that was going to move forward with them, or if that was an anomaly, a 1 year really awesome thing. I was hoping, and I know we all were, that that was going to be a beginning of a culture shift and things would shift with it. It's interesting. I will note in the news and notes real quickly, you know, we really love Barry Trotz. Carol was on the record saying we needed to find a way to keep him. The Islanders have just fired Barry Trotz, which I found really surprising. Wow. He's about to go into another lame duck year. And I'd like to say we know how that turned out for the Capitals, but it actually turned out really well for the Capitals. You know, they won the cup on the lame duck year. So you would think that if you were an Islanders person, that you might give them one chance, especially the first 20 games were on the road, Carol. And then they had so many injuries and sicknesses throughout. And somehow they still, you know, put him on the chopping block. But I mean, Lou does this a lot, right? I think he's a crazy, you know, person that I don't see it. But anyway, regardless, it's interesting to see. And obviously we didn't get the right coach right after the cup. Now I think we have a good coach in there. I'm hoping he's been able to make adjustments game by game, which has been a good thing to see. But it's going to be interesting to see if long-term, whether or not we stick with Sammy, if he goes back and forth like he did in Carolina, or what happens going forward. But to speak to this game just real fast, I mean, I think you guys have broken it down very well. It was exciting that we got on the board first. I'm so sad that Tom Wilson has been injured, and we haven't really seen him at all. Like, they're doing a good job of, like, hiding him from all media. Like, and I know that often they don't tell you what the injury is, or you don't, you know, they try to disguise it, but usually he's seen by a camera somewhere. The only pictures I've seen of him in the last 3 days were his own Instagram stories that had his leg covered up, right? So, like, I haven't seen any shot of him outside of his house, nothing. Supposedly.
But wasn't he seen, like he was seen on the second game in a suit, like, watching the game.
I don't even know, but I, regardless of set game two and on, I just haven't seen him in a while. I don't even know if he made it with the team.
But the coach said that he will be traveling. He's day to day, and it's a game time decision for him to play in game five. He's been probably doing rehab and, you know, trying to get well.
But Carol, have you ever seen that where, like, we don't even see a picture of the guy? Like, I mean, it's like, it's so bizarre to me.
But nothing getting leaked. You know, they wanted to keep the Panthers because this DC sports media, they leak, they can't hold anything. They're a bad refrigerator. They can't keep nothing. And, you know, you give the other team advantages, like with the Washington Commanders, with them announcing, or they're not going to re-sign Daron Payne. Now the team has no kind of capital to try to trade him because everybody knows that he's going to be a free agent and he can walk at the end of the year. So they're being smart and not letting him be seen because they know somebody's going to take a picture. If he has a brace on or something, or he's limping, then they're going to put it out there. And then that's going to be in Florida. You know, they don't know if he's going to be there. He's not. So they have to game plan for him. So that's taking some of the strategy out of the game. So I'm glad that they're doing that and not letting.
No, I'm happy about it. It's just I've never seen it so successfully done. Where, like, not a pitcher has been seen. So, like, but it's crazy. In 90 seconds of playing time, which is all that our friend Tom Wilson has had, he had a goal, a penalty. I mean, like, he made the most of those 90 seconds. I'll give him credit for that. But it's just frustrating. But Cousy, a great goal in the third period in a game where we were down 2-1, and I was really nervous. And then TJ Oshie, you know, really, you know, just a timely goal to make it 3-2, and then Lars Eller with the empty netter. But, you know, the Oshie one with the pass by Backstrom was perfect. I really like them shifting up the lines. You know, Mantha's done really well. You know, Eller's played well. We've seen people stepping up through all of it because, honestly, we'll talk about this throughout, Ovechkin's not the one scoring all the goals like it is some playoffs. Like, it's pretty much like everyone's contributing.
Which is how it should be.
Right, but and like how we saw in 2018. But
we're getting ahead of ourselves. Let's get into game two. We still haven't gotten to game two yet.
Okay, that's fair.
And honestly, game two is like, I've got like three sentences and we're so we have Thursday with a totally different story. We have no Tom Wilson, which sucks. Panthers score five times. And the only capital goal was by Nick Backstrom with a power play goal in the second period at 2:44. There's really nothing else to say.
But at the time it made it 2-1. So that's the one good thing. And I'll just say that obviously then allowing a goal 30 seconds or so later, is just a buzzkill, right? And I didn't watch any of this game, so I'm going to let you and Carol break it down, and then I'll give my thoughts on game three. But Carol, what was your takeaway on game two?
This game was definitely going the Capitals' way early. It was a fluke goal that got Florida their first goal. Not fluke as it was, not a good goal, but it was a deflection, a high deflection that just trickled over the shoulder and went in. And that kind of took all the momentum that the Capitals had, because they, at that point, Florida had no type of offensive anything going on. The Capitals were playing their game, dumping it down deep, getting the forecheck going. There was nothing there. You want to get in their zone, get it in, get it out. and getting the transition game and slowing them down. That's what was working. And then, you know, I can say NHL playoff hockey, you know, one goal can lead to more. And, you know, like I said, they scored two goals within 30 seconds. Like I said, Nicky made it 2-1. And unfortunately, Florida is a good team. They were a President's Trophy team. They scored more goals than anybody since, what they said, 1975 or something. So, I mean, they're a good team. They were at home. You know, they seized the momentum and took it. And the Capitals had some breakdowns. They weren't playing solid hockey because with the line, this is, I had to talk about, I gotta put him out there because game three, he had a hell of a game. So I got to talk about him in game two. But Hathaway, on that third goal, he was the key element without the hustle on that being bumped up to the third line. I think he was out of sync. You know, he missed his line mates. He hadn't been up on the third line, and I don't know how long. I know he had been up there before, but it's been a minute, and he just didn't have any – it looked like he was just out of place. And on his effort on that third goal, which kind of, you know, opened the avalanche because they got the next goal 30 seconds later, then it was, you know, pretty much a done deal with them at home, crowd behind them, knowing how pivotal the game was. The Caps couldn't, you know, get season momentum back. And Florida was, you know, taking some liberties, which, you know, goes to not having Tom Wilson out there. They were, I felt like they were getting away with some, you know, late hits. You know, the puck had been away from the player, but they were still allowed to make contact and get a hit. And if it was the other way around, they would have definitely called it on the Capitals. But this was a, you know, winnable game up until, you know, the floodgates opened for Florida. But it's still, you know, the team was in it. They didn't have Wilson for the whole game. And, you know, Florida knew that, and they seized the momentum, and they showed why they're the President's Trophy winning team in the NHL and scored so many goals. So, you know, game two was game two. They left Florida and tied 1-1, which is, you know, you say you want to steal one. If they had stole two, that would have been great. But you accomplish your mission, come home, and make sure you take care of home ice.
Right. Anna, any quick thoughts before we get into the more exciting game three?
Yeah. I found there's a complete disconnect with this, with the team, and it just seemed to be right from the start, unfortunately. And I don't know if it was because Tommy wasn't on ice and, you know, he's such a key factor in things, but you want your team to rally regardless. But there just says, it seems like there was just something off. It was a tough game to watch. A lot of sloppy passes, a lot of, you know, shoot the puck moments that just didn't quite happen. So, but I agree. It's, you know, Florida Panthers aren't in the playoffs for, you know, just because, like, they're a damn good team, and we knew that they were going to challenge the Capitals for sure. Unfortunately, I think that they were, just, I don't know, a little stunned and a little, they just got their asses handed to them basically in this game. So luckily we redeemed ourselves in the following game on Saturday afternoon.
Yeah. One last thing I'll just say is I want to echo what Carol was saying about the lines. I like Hathaway on the third line, and I kind of wish that they had put McMichael, you know, in on this game. I know McMichael plays better as a center, but if you really feel that way, then put McMichael as the center on the third line and put Eller on the wing. We had tried that before. I think I would have rather them do that than what they did do, because then they changed the chemistry of two different lines, and, you know, that is basically changing half your lines, and you could see the result of that. Plus, Florida was going to push, right? I mean, they're the best home team in the league. The likelihood of them losing both at home was pretty small, but I was happy with the split, but we had to take care of business, and we did. And so, Carol, or Anna, break down the scoring in this really awesome game, and then I definitely want to break that down with Carol as well.
100%. All right. So Saturday afternoon, we had game three, and at 2:45, the Panthers score their only goal of the game. That's all we need to say. Just kidding. So following that, Oshie with a tip-in on a power play goal at 19:34, which is fantastic. Going in the second period, Mojo. There we go. I will have to say he has sort of been like my Orlov, and I've been like meh with him for when the trade happened, but I will say he is redeeming himself, and I'm becoming more and more of a Mojo supporter back on the Capitals this time. So he scores at 19:51, assisted by Mantha and Backstrom. TVR, love it, at 18:49, assisted by Mojo and Nikki. Third period, here's the captain scoring at 10:25 with the power play goal. Carlson with an empty netter at 19:18. And then Hathaway, assisted by Larson and Dowd. I think my times were a little bit off on that one. 19:18 was Hathaway, assisted by Larson and Dowd. And with the stars, Sammy, Mojo, and TVR. This was, to me, the 60 minutes of hockey. This was physical. This was smart hockey. And this is probably one of the best games I've seen them play, at least the second half of the season, for sure.
Yeah, Carol, I'll let you give your thoughts first, and then I'll give my take.
Yeah, I was actually watching this game at work. It was kind of hard to – first time ever watching a playoff hockey game at work and having to try to compose yourself. but it was definitely a very well-played game by the Capitals. They got the first goal, which I didn't really like the goal that he gave up, but – he, you know, said at the end of the game, you know, first 5 minutes of the game, he felt nervous. He gave up that goal 2:45 into the game, but then he gave up nothing else. So, I mean, I appreciated that. Like I said, he gave up a bad goal, but the team was able to respond. Once again, they slowed him down in the neutral zone. They out-hit him. They shut him down in the power play when they did commit penalties. They got power play goals when they got a chance to go on the power play. They got timely saves. Samsonov had that great save that led to the goal to take the lead in this game. Everything was clicking. The crowd was behind them. It was going crazy in there. It was a perfect game to play at home, and you were hoping they would copy and paste that for game four. But this is definitely a well-executed game plan, a well-played game. Defensively, they were pretty solid. I believe they only had two odd man rushes, Florida did in transition. So they did a real good job of, you know, shutting down this Florida offense that was so potent that everybody was scared of, that they wasn't giving the Capitals any chance to even being in the same arena with this team. And the Capitals showed that, look, you know, we might not be the high scoring offense. Hey, we've been the President Trophy winning team before, and we know the pressure that's on the team to perform. And they applied the pressure in game three and made Florida, you know, feel the same way they put five on the Capitals in Florida. Caps turned right around to the sixth on in the next game. So that's a great bounce back for the team and a good way to show them that they can impose their will and play their game and shut them down at any given time if they play their hockey. So the way I look at it is, it's not what about the Florida Panthers can do. It's about how the Capitals play. And if they play their game, if they can shut down Florida, they can shut down any team in the NHL. That's just my opinion.
Yeah, so there's a lot to unpack there. One of the things is Sammy played really well in the third period of the previous game, and something that we didn't really talk a lot about because we kind of, you know, overlooked that game. Mm-hmm. And I thought he deserved the chance to start this game, and he really shined in both this game and the next one. I don't blame, you know, the loss in the next game on him either. I think he's really stepped up big in a way that we were kind of hoping for. This is his very first career playoff win, just like Double V's very first win was the game one win. I thought, I wore the Mantha Ray shirt again. I thought he was the best player on the ice potentially. He was trying to take the physical presence that Tommy, you know, was left behind. You know, there's such a void there, and he really tried his best. I mean, he has had his most productive hitting series, you know, that we've ever seen. You know, it just, he was able to put up 10 hits one game. Just really, you know, ratcheting that up a lot. And then really a beautiful play to set up Marcus Johansson. I mean, without that shot, you know, shot and setting that up, he's not going to score that. And then right, you know, then later on, he was the cause of the Ovechkin goal. You know, he had a pass down low. And then there's another goal that I think even the one in between was the one where he set up the play and he was basically be the fourth person to have touched it, but you don't get it. You know, he's not the secondary assist, but he really set up a lot of that play too. So, I mean, he was responsible for three of these six goals in a lot of ways. And I just
loving really, his game.
Yeah, he really has stepped it up a lot. And I like that line with Nick Backstrom and Marcus Johansson. That's become a very potent line. And we really needed a really good second line to try to compete with the four amazing lines that Florida has. And the last thing I'll say is the OV goal happened on the power play. I was just thinking to myself 2 minutes before, I'm going to have to do a spot on this show tonight about how the Capitals are scoring all these goals and playing really well. And Ovechkin is yet to score a goal. And what's going on? We're three games in and then he scores a goal, but still the only one he has, you know, placed, you know, a lot of other people have got goals as well. So just an all around great game, but we'll for timing purposes, move on into the next game, which I know is a much more frustrating game that we have a lot of opinions on.
Yes, we do. All right. So last night, second home game. I don't know. Really thought we had it, but that's okay. We'll see. First period, Oshie with a deflected power play goal at 7:15, assisted by Carlson and Nikki. Panthers score at 14:08. So now we are tied 1-1. No goals in the second. And then the third period, Kuzi scores at 9:31, assisted by Ovi and Oshie. Panthers tie it up at 17:56, and we head into overtime. And unfortunately, at 4:57, they score. This game, honestly, it didn't bother me as much until I had to write down like shots on goal stats. And I thought, nah, the hell, like on paper, it looked like we really played quite a shitty game. But you're looking at shots on goal with Capitals 7, Panthers 11, 4 and 12, 5 and 7, you know, it was just that kind of stuff. It was like, it was incredibly frustrating to see those stats, knowing that I thought we really had a chance to pull it out in the end. And, you know, it just didn't happen. So
real quickly, a crazy barehanded one-handed catch and throw down the line to first base. And the guy just barely stretches out and touches first base. As he's falling over, and it's an important out because this is still a one-run game. But Carol, I don't know if you saw that in the Nats game, but it was a pretty
barehanded.
He just like grabbed it. And he really like sold out for it, grabbed it, and you know.
That's amazing. That'd be like after the fact, you'd be like, "Holy!"
Yeah,
you know, Mikhail Franco's been playing pretty well for the team, especially offensively.
Wow.
Offensively, he's been a little spotty, but he's definitely been solid in the field playing third base. So yeah, he's made some nice plays throughout the season.
Yeah. So anyway, but real quickly, I just wanted to talk about just the bad luck that we had. I mean, there was a chance for Hathaway to score an empty net goal that would have sealed the deal. It bounces off the post and out. In an extended 6-on-5 situation they're doing for over 3 minutes where we were just getting worn down and worn down and worn down. And then unfortunately it's icing. So those players have to stay on. And later on in that shift, the puck goes off of Hathaway right to their player and they, you know, shoot it and score and tie the game. And I've seen this story so many times and it's so frustrating because I know Carol was trying to cheer me up in the in our group chat saying, "We got this, we got this, we got this." And I just was like, "We don't got this. This is gonna be awful." I've seen this story where, you know, less than 2 minutes they score 6-on-5, and it rarely goes our way in overtime after, you know, momentum swings like that. But yeah, I was hoping Carol would be right. I did not, you know, I'm the eternal pessimist. Carol's the eternal optimist. Anna gets a little glimpse of this in our group chat, but I knew the momentum. I was so angry at I'm just so frustrated that Hathaway, I mean, he had to shoot it there. You don't want them to steal it. They were so tired, but it's just like, I almost wish he could have skated it out a little bit more and found a way to get that in. And it's such a different series when you're up 3-1 because we had stolen home ice and we give it right back to them, which I know we've been playing really well on the road, but still, like, I would have loved for them to have to win three in a row to beat us. If we had won that game, that's what they would have had to do. And now they just have to win, you know, two out of three. But it's just so frustrating. But Carol, what are your thoughts?
It was definitely a frustrating ending. Florida definitely made adjustments. They clogging the passing lanes. They were definitely very defensively solid in this game. That's why the low shot count for the Capitals, because the Capitals had plays to be made, but they had to be perfect plays because Florida was playing solid defensively. They got the goal late by Kuzi to take the lead. It was about 9 minutes left in the game. I felt pretty good about that because we've seen this team, you know, locked down defensively.
Were you okay with the bird there?
Not really. I don't like poking the bear. Now, if it was like 3 minutes left, yeah, I'd have been cool.
I want to revisit this someday because I don't think you're ever cool with it. I've yet to find the time.
I mean, I wasn't even upset that he did it. I mean, it was a little baby one anyway. It wasn't an extended one, so I get it. It was a momentum swing. You know, they felt like they had the momentum, and I felt it too because I pulled up in front of the house, and as soon as I pulled up, they scored. So I was like, bet, I'm going in the house to watch this last 9 minutes and watch them solidify the thing. I didn't see him do it until, you know, he talked about it after the fact. So I didn't, you know, I wasn't upset about it. Playoff hockey, you get emotional. So, you know, he at home crowd.
All right, Carol, so far what I'm learning and listening to this whole podcast so far is that when you watch it, either on the road listening or when you're at work, we seem to do a lot better. So maybe you just pitch a tent at your office. Yeah, pitch a tent at your office and just watch it there. And just watch the.
I didn't get home and then I watched the game. So I don't know, man. It was, it was frustrating. I mean, the 6-on-5, you know, they had a comeback team. You know, that's where they've scored a lot of goals. But the reason why they've had to come back is because they don't play defensively sound. And if you play solid hockey against them, you can slow them down and stop their strength, which is transition and the rush. So, I mean, that's why I was upset because I know there was a great opportunity to go up 3-1 and, you know, put a stranglehold and put all the pressure on Florida going home, knowing that we had beat them at home in the first game. And, you know, like you said, inches with Hathaway's empty net attempt going, you know, just bouncing off of the pipe. Unfortunately, all of that, you know, I took a step back. Like I said, it's the best team in the league. They didn't get it. Nobody gave the Capitals a chance. I believe it's up to two of the analysts that say the Caps in 7. But they're in this series. They're minus one of their most crucial players in Tom Wilson. He plays on the penalty kill, the power play. He's solid.
And I think for this series specifically, maybe the most crucial. I truly believe if he was out for all four games, we may have swept this series, Carol. I know that's such a ballsy statement. But I really feel like
I agree with that because even just the first 3 minutes of the game and 90 minutes, 90 seconds he played on the ice, you saw the impact he was going to have on the game. So Florida lucked up with him, you know, getting this injury. I'm just hopeful that he'll be able to, if he's not 100% healthy for game 5, that he'll be ready for game 6 at home. And the Capitals know if they can get him healthy for game 6 at home, not saying this a lot, but they got a very good chance of winning. So they know they need to handle their business and play game 5 like they played game 1 and not like they played game 2.
I couldn't believe how quickly John Carlson got back out there after getting a puck in the face. I know we haven't really talked about that. Like, he missed one shift, Carol, and he was like faucet bleeding out of his face. Like, I know that we've talked about him all season, but like, what a gutsy performance by him and so many Capitals. I thought we played really well. My one issue is we had opportunities. We had 5 power plays. We only converted 1 of them. I really felt like we needed to convert more. I've been so happy with how the penalty kill has played. I don't even want to say it for, you know, sake of jinxing it, but they've been playing incredible. And for me,
going every game, Florida hasn't scored. They're the only team in the playoffs that hasn't scored a power play.
Knocking on the wood here, but like
I am knocking.
that unit is locked in. They were locked in before the pro season started.
Yeah, I agree. I know, but they're such a deadly. We know how good that power play is. But regardless of that, we can't win many games without 20 shots on goal. Like, we almost did. And that would have shocked the hell out of me. It's just, you know, Bobrovsky's too good. I've talked about this a couple times before on this show. I talked about it last week. To win this series, we've got to win some 3-2 games. We've got to hold them to half of their scoring output of their normal thing, which is crazy. They usually score 4 all season. We have to cut them to 2, and we've got to put up 3 goals. Ovi can have one of them, but 2 other people are going to have to show up at least. That was going to be our recipe for success. And we saw some success. I mean, we actually scored more than that. But we could have won that game 3-2 if the Hathaway goal goes in, and it would be exactly what I'm talking about. But I really feel like we need to cut down on the penalties in the next game if we want to win, especially there, because you know at home they're going to give them a bunch of power plays. So we got to really try to mitigate that. And then the other thing is we need to have more shots on goal. Like, I just don't think we're going to – if we shoot less than 20 times on goal, I don't know if we're going to score enough to beat this team. And I think if we could do those two things, we could be quite successful. But what do you think, Carol?
I mean, Florida blocked a lot of shots. Like I said, last game, they were the most solid offensively all postseason than they had been, you know, throughout. They were back-checking. They were, they were staying defensively strategic. They stuck to their game plan. They weren't taking chances. And they played like their back was against the wall. So I really don't have any complaints about the Cowboys game. They just have to get more net front presence. If you're going to get low amount of shots, but you have to get traffic in front of them. So if you're going to, you know, when you do get those opportunities, you need to make those opportunities count. And we've seen them do that in previous games, unfortunately, because the intensity of what Florida was playing with and how, like I said, if you go back and look at it, they played this game very well against the Capitals to hold them to only those limited amount of shots. They were blocking shots. They were back checking. They were the forwards was helping out the defense, just like we've seen the Capitals doing with the Florida, they're stopping them on their rush. They did the same thing to the Capitals. So they gave the Capitals a dose of their medicine. So now they're going to come out there and adjust. And I believe they will. And I don't know if they don't have Wilson for this game. Like I said, I think that's what they're going to be playing for. They know if they take this game and they know they're coming back home with Wilson the chance to play and they get their lines back to the way it was in game one, the way it would have been. And then they can really, you know, show Florida what they're really about and take them out of the playoffs and shut everybody's mouth.
Yeah, 2 quick things. One is, well, I agree with everything that you said. I think that he could be a difference maker in this series. I really feel I'm so happy that TJ Oshie didn't get supplemental discipline. I didn't think he should, but you know how things are called in this league, that, you know, the same exact play was done against us, wasn't called. I was just getting, you know, there was just a lot of talk on Twitter, but there's always a lot of talk on Twitter on every play. But
with his own stick and they tried to push you for it.
Right. But anyway, so it was whether he came up on him, regardless, wonderful hit. It set up that entire play, you know, that ended up with Guzzi getting the goal. You know, he's been such a physical presence. We've seen the physicality from all the players. We need that to continue, but to, you know, stay within themselves. You know, I think, you know, Favari took some penalties. We got lucky that they didn't score on them. I'm happy he almost got a goal on a breakaway. Yeah, after we killed the second one. But he just got to stay out of the box in my mind and keep that physical presence, but not take it too far. We've got a question from Eric in the on Facebook. He was asking, are the Caps going to win this series? He thinks so. And so it's going to be a tough one. I really feel like whoever wins this next game will be in the driver's seat, because then the other team would have to win 2 in a row at the end. It's been going every other. I like the adjustments that our coach has made. And I also like our road mentality, but they are a great team at home. Carol, what are your thoughts going forward in this series?
I'm going Caps in 6.
6, okay.
I'm going Caps in 6.
I like it. You're the eternal optimist. I hope that
because of the way these last couple of games went without Wilson. Because like I said, Florida's been getting away with, you know, a little extracurricular activities that the referees miraculously don't see, but they catch everything that the Capitals do. So it's, I know the Capitals are getting frustrated by it, and, you know, somebody's going to have to drop the glove sooner or later. And I'm hoping it's Hathaway, or dial one of them fourth line guys that could really, you know, handle themselves, because Florida's been getting away with some things. Referees haven't been calling it, so they need to send a message. And because Wilson hasn't been out there, you know, they've been getting away with some stuff, messing with Cousy. Cousy got the $5,000 fine for, you know, high sticking on the play. I'm surprised they didn't see it during the game. But, yeah, dude was messing with him. He's like, man, no, get out of here. He smacked him with a stick. That's cool. If Wilson was out there, he wouldn't be doing that. So I think that the team is going to, you know, come out there and know what they have to do. And I think they're going to handle their business. And then if Wilson is healthy to go game six, that momentum with him and Capital One going to be rocking and they get all the lines back to where they want them, I think they're going to have another game like game three and not like game four.
Carol, I have a quick question. In your studio there, do you have either of the hockey games on? For some reason, I tried
taking a 36-hour break from hockey because I didn't want to hear the commentators.
Oh, but no, I just didn't know if you wanted to just watch the Bruins or the Lightning game. So real quick, I just want to give a
score. Crap at this Carolina game.
I know. Carolina's up 5-1. It's pretty much the end of the third. There's 25 seconds left. And what some reason, my, of course, of all nights, ESPN is just not working, or ESPN2 on my TV. So that's why I'm watching other things. But I have to reset the cable box. But I realized that like 5 minutes before airtime. So anyway, the Hurricanes are going to take a 3-2 lead here over the Bruins, which was to be expected. And then in the other series, it's 2-2. The Lightning took a 2-0 lead in this game pretty early on, within the first 6 minutes, back-to-back by Stamkos and Hedman. In the second period, Tavares scores a goal to make it 2-1. Morgan Rielly, 3 minutes into the third period, ties it. And then 1 minute later, William Nylander scores to make it 3-2. There's 12:40 left in this very close game. Again, Tampa Bay was winning, and Toronto is coming back. I'm rooting for Toronto in this series. I feel like Tampa Bay has won two cups in a row. I have a lot of friends that are up in Toronto. I think I'd personally rather play Toronto with their history of not going that far in the playoffs versus the two-time defending champs. If those are my choices, we still have to get, obviously, past Florida, but I just wanted to mention those two live games that were happening right now. But, Anna, what are your thoughts on this series going forward for the Capitals?
Well, I'm going to go with Carol 100% on this one. I'm thinking Caps and six. I think that we have seen a team step up when you don't have a Tommy in the line. And it's been impressive. And I think they just need to ride that confidence wave. I do think that as much as I'd love to see someone, you know, drop the gloves, I hesitate, you know, with the fact that Florida knows that you've got that kind of ticking time bomb with Hathaway. It doesn't take much for doubt, and certainly doesn't take much for Mantha. And I'd rather see them on the ice playing smart hockey than, you know, in the penalty box for something stupid. But then again, you know, I'm always going to root for a good fight. So I see it. I just think that, you know, the team getting a good headspace and
as long as they're taking out a better player than who's going out for us, that's my rule of thumb. We can knock out like somebody who's actually would be scoring or doing something. I don't want like one of our, yeah, I would hate for someone like, I don't know, Mantha Ray, who I think is a big guy and can probably take care of his own, to like go out with a fourth liner and then he's off the ice for a considerable amount of time. Like, it's important that like, it kind of think of it like chess, where like you want to have the same sort of, you know, strength piece that's being taken out, you know, and I'm not putting yourself in it.
I'm all, you know, loving a good hockey fight and stuff, but not if it's going to take, like you said, like Amantha, Dowd, or Hathaway off the ice. It's, you know, come on, at that point, it's not really worth it. But yeah, these guys just, you know, get into a group. It's like, come on now. It's like now or never. And I think they're going to do well. They do well on the road. So bring it home in six and let's just rock it.
Yeah, I actually think it's going to go seven. The Caps are going to win, but they win both road games and lose their home game is what I'm feeling, because that's kind of how the entire season has gone. And the Capitals never make it easy for anything. So like, it's just would be very typical Capitals to win the next one, have a chance to finish it off, not do it, but then go on the road and win it there. Win. That story has actually happened before. I believe it was the Boston series a bunch of years back in 2012, maybe. I think that's how it went.
Against the Pens, they did it in six. on the road in Pittsburgh.
But it's opposite, though. We'd have to do it at home in game six.
They know how critical it is to put your foot on their throat and close the door. They know what they know how to do it, and they will do it. That's why I'm not even worried about it. This team is ready. It's more even with Florida than a lot of folks want to give them credit for. They looked at the goals and all of the, you know, the half line scoring that they did. But the Capitals, you know, got off to a great start, had some injuries, had some COVID stuff, brought some, you know, young people in the lineup, had some inconsistent goals at the time. But they were on the pace to, you know, be in the running for the President's Trophy at one point in time. But everybody got locked in. Pittsburgh got hot. Rangers got hot. Carolina got hot. And they fell the way they fell. But they're still one of the best teams in this league, offensively and defensively and special teams.
Yeah, no eighth seed's ever had 100 points. So, like, you know, it's something to consider is that it's not a typical eight seed at all. Real quickly, Carol, have you seen any of the other series?
Yeah, I've been watching off and on. I haven't been paying close attention, but I've been watching them, you know, throughout.
I'm just going to give people a quick update if they haven't been. The Avalanche swept the Predators, and they won 5-3 yesterday. Unfortunately, the Penguins won 7-2 over the Rangers in game four of round one and now have a 3-1 lead. That goes back to New York tomorrow. That'll be a pivotal game. The Flames beat the Stars 4-1 in their last game to tie that series, where I believe it was split for both the home and the away games for both teams. And then tonight the Kings play the Oilers at 10 o'clock. That series is tied 2-2. And the Blues play the Wild. That game actually just started. That game is still 0-0 with about 16 minutes left in the first period. So a lot of really close series. A lot of them are really tight. Carol, any thoughts on any of those series that you want to break down before we start to end the hockey segment?
They've all been, like I said, very interesting series. Most of them tied 2-2. Pittsburgh up 3-1. Shesterkin, it was crazy to see him give up so many goals the last two games, and the way he was locked in all season, but maybe it's fatigue. I'm not sure. Because the last time I checked the score, it was like 2-2. The next thing I know, so the final score was 7-2. And I was like, geez, what happened? But then the Boston Carolina, that's been a crazy one. You know, home ice has been the key. And that one might go seven. Depending on what Boston do going back home. Toronto, Tampa Bay, that's been a crazy series too. You know, Toronto started out with a 5-0, you know, butt kicking, and Tampa Bay came back and got it with a 6-1 butt kicking, or maybe it was worse than that. So they had a contentious season battle, and it's leaked over into the playoffs. So there's been some very interesting playoffs. The West Coast, I haven't watched a lot. The Edmonton King series, that's been interesting with the goalie matchup and you know, the older Kings against the young, high-scoring, fast-flying Edmonton Oilers. So there's been a lot of good storylines. So for the first round of the NHL playoffs, it's been great in my opinion.
Erica asked me, missed the Tom Wilson update. I missed that question a few minutes ago, but we think that it's day to day. We don't know if he'll play.
He's taking the trip, and they say day to day, he's a game time decision at this point.
Yep. So, which is basically what they said before every game. So, mm-hmm. Anna, have you watched any of the other playoff games? Do you have any
other series? Honestly, just the Carolina Pitts, Carolina Bruins.
Boston. Yeah.
But you know, just to kind of see, it's been fun to watch. It's more high scoring than I thought it would be, but you know, always kind of hoping someone's going to beat Marchand's ass at some point. But there's been a couple good roughing moments there for sure. But some of the other games I have not been able to watch, and just kind of focused really on the Capitals. But of course, it's playoff season, so it's always very exciting.
We definitely have to mention all the backup and the third string goalies that's been in the first.
Yeah, round. Crazy. I'm happy that teams are allowed to have three goalies, and I'm happy that you're allowed to have one in the stands that you can emergency dress, right?
Yeah. Because
otherwise, we'd have a lot of Zamboni drivers going in.
A lot of Zamboni drivers.
But Yeah, it's been a crazy playoffs for sure. So we'll I think we'll probably the Blues just scored and make 1-0. So that was less than 5 minutes into that game. And the Lightning scored 8:33. That's a tie game now, 3-3. So that's an exciting game that I'm frustrated that my cable will not show me. I'll try to maybe fix that during the baseball segment. Carol, any final thoughts on the hockey before we let Anna go?
No, I was just watching a bad play by Juan Soto. Missed the cutoff, man. Instead of it being first and third with no outs in the top of the ninth, it's second and third with no outs in the top of the ninth with Ramirez on in relief trying to get it to the bottom of the ninth for the Nets to try to walk off. And, just a bad throwing baseball play on Soto, missing the cutoff, man, and allowing the man to advance to second. So, Nets trying to pull this one out. We're about to talk Max in a little while and talk about some of the heartbreaking losses that they snatched defeat from the draft with victory a couple of times last week.
Well, Anna, I hope that next week isn't a recap of the season episode and it's wow, we get to play Toronto or Tampa Bay episode. And just for people to know, the games are every other day. We don't necessarily know the time for game six yet. We do know that tomorrow's game is at 7:30. Yes, and the Penguins Rangers is at 7, and Stars Flames is at 9:30 in that one. And then we'd play Friday. The time is to be determined. If there needs to be a game seven, it would be on Sunday, time to be determined as well in Florida. So, yeah, all the games are still on Comcast, NBC Sports Washington, and they will be for the rest of round one, and then we lose our favorite commentators after that. But hopefully they'll do well, Anna, and I know that I think you missed this week's show on Power Play, but if anyone wants to catch Gil giving his update on these, they can definitely check out the podcast partners button. Anna, any final thoughts before we let you go?
Nope, just go Caps.
Yep, go Caps.
All right, thanks, guys. Let's hope for a great week, and I'll see you next Monday, hopefully.
Yeah.
All right, talk to you next week.
Take care, guys. Bye.
Hey. All right, I'll let Brian come on in, and I will take my little break here, and I'll let you guys break down a baseball week that seemed very up and down and frustrating, but I'll be listening, and I'll come back to talk a little bit of basketball talk when you guys are done.
Yeah, it was definitely a frustrating and inconsistent week for the Nationals. They gave you some glimpse of hope that they might be able to turn it around. They definitely started scoring when they went on the road. They were getting better starting pitching, which has been one of the issues for the season throughout. The bullpen has been solid. Unfortunately, lately, the bullpen has been falling off. As we've seen tonight, as I said, they had a 2-0 lead, and the bullpen comes and immediately gives up 3 runs. And now the Mets just got a sacrifice fly to make it 4-2 in the top of the ninth with one man out, man on second and third. So Mets trying to hopefully hold this thing, not get a crooked number on the board and make it harder for them to come back in the bottom of the ninth. But going up against the top ranked Mets, still can't believe I'm saying that. But yeah, the top ranked Mets in this first game is a little frustrating. It's been an epitome of this season so far. Get a lead, finally get some quality pitching from Corbin, and then the bullpen, which has been so solid, let you down and be the most in this game. So we'll keep you updated during this Nats Talk segment to see if the Nats can pull this victory out. They're currently sitting 10-20. They were 2-4 last week, 4-6 the last 10. And like I said, it's been a frustrating start to the season, but that was to be expected coming into the rebuild and trading away some of the players we traded away last season. But before we get into it, Brian, how's it going, man? I know you and the Yankees are still riding high over there in the AL East. I think I did see y'all took a crazy loss to the Orioles. I know you don't probably want to talk about that. Well, they might have The Orioles, who knows? I just saw the score flash up, and I said, I know Brian's probably cussing the TV out right now.
Well, actually, the Yankees did not play the Orioles this weekend. The Yankees are on fire right now. They're playing some great baseball, and I'm sorry. I'll apologize to everybody in advance if I seem distracted, because the Yankees are in a really close game right now with the Blue Jays, who is really their top competition in the AL East this year. It's tied 3-3 in the eighth inning, so I apologize to everybody if I seem distracted during this segment. But Yankees are on fire right now. I'm in a good mood because of it. I'm happy to be here with you, CP3, talk a little bit about the Nats. Bit of a tough week for the Nats, but I'm still happy to be here to talk about it anyway.
All right, man. Appreciate it. I don't know what game I was talking about there. I've been watching some.
Yeah, we didn't play the Orioles this week. I'm not sure where he got that from.
Yeah, must have been the Orioles beating somebody I wasn't expecting to beat. That's probably
what. Yeah.
That was hearing how bad they were supposed to be. I honestly checked them out. Got to get Tim on to talk about them one day. But, yeah, all right, let's get into the Nats.
I will just say the Orioles are not in last place. The Red Sox are, so.
Wow.
Yeah. I just want to say that.
I know you're happy to say that. Very happy.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
All right, let's get into the week that was for the Nationals. They ended up their road trip with a three-game set against Colorado and a three-game set to finish up against the Los Angeles Angels and getting the chance to see good old buddy Tony Two Bags and see the great Mike Trout and that damn Ohtani with him in that third game that I'm still a little upset about. But let's go ahead and start out with one of the victories of the week last week. It was the first game against Colorado. It was a 10-2 victory. Eric Fetty earned his second victory of the season. That puts him at 2-2. He went 7 innings, giving up 6 hits, 1 run, 3 strikeouts, and 3 walks. Jermaine Marquez took the loss. That dropped him to 0-2. He went 5 innings, giving up 10 hits, 7 earned runs, with 5 strikeouts and 2 walks. The Nats got a 3-run home run by Josh Bell in the top of the third to get the scoring started. Top of the fourth, Robles had a sacrifice fly. Top of the fifth, Soto hit a solo home run. Ruiz had a 2-RBI single in the top of the seventh. Yadier Hernandez had a 2-run RBI double in the top of the ninth. Ruiz ended up scoring with the RBI single. Game two was a 5-2 loss. Let's see. Pronounce that name. I'm going to just say his last name. Goldberg for Colorado earned the victory. That put him at 2-2. He went 6 2/3, giving up 7 hits, 2 earned runs with 6 strikeouts and 1 walk. Patrick Corbin drops to 0-5. He went 6 innings, giving up 7 hits, 5 runs, 3 of those earned, 3 strikeouts, no walks. And Daniel Bard. He got the save. That was his 7th save of the season. He went 1 inning, giving up no hits, no runs, or 2 strikeouts, and no walks. The top of the third, Christian Hernandez had an RBI single. And the top of the eighth, Lane Thomas hit a solo home run to account for the 2 runs for the Nats. And the last game of the series was a 9-7 loss. Another first name, I'm not even going to try to. Chassin, I could never get his first name right. Oh. I'm going to try it, Brian. I'm going to try it. Rolis Chassin. I know it's probably not right, but I'm going to give it a damn shot. He won the game. That put him at 1-2. Went 1 2/3, giving 2 hits, 1 earned run with 1 strikeout and no walks. Aaron Sanchez earned took the loss. That drops him to 1-2. He went 4 1/3, giving him 6 hits, 7 runs. 6 of those earned with 4 strikeouts and 2 walks. And Daniel Baird earned his 8th save of the season, going 1 inning, giving him 1 hit with no runs, no strikeouts, and no walks. Top of the first, Juan Soto got things started with the solo home run. Top of the fifth, Josh Bell had an RBI double. Top of the sixth, Ruiz had a solo home run. Top of the seventh, Mikel Franco had an RBI double. And Ruiz got him home with the RBI double to follow that up at the top of the seventh. And the top of the eighth, Christian Fernandez had an RBI ground out to account for all the Nats scoring, but they couldn't come all the way back and earn the series win. Colorado was, you know, one of the better teams in the West, even though they have what was at the time a 16-9, they were third in the division, but they're in a tough division. So they're a solid team. The Nats had a chance to win two out of three, had a chance to win all three, but unfortunately, like I said, errors and, you know, some faulty starting pitching and sometimes some faulty mid relievers. And, you know, they're still trying to find their way, but, you know, it's a long season. We've seen worse, and hopefully they can get things on the right track. And like I said, we're still missing Strasburg, still missing Ross. And, you know, also have to announce that Gerardo Parra officially retired, is now in a front office capacity working with Mike Rizzo on talent and development. So got to announce that too. So the Baby Shark has officially hung up his cleats and is now in the front office for the Nationals. But Brian, what did you take away from this Colorado series with the Nats? Because they actually did, you know, Nats did come alive and did get some better pitching than they were getting at home on that ugly home stand that we had before they went on the road.
Yeah, first off, I echo what you said about Parra. Obviously a great Nat, will always be remembered for 2019 and Baby Shark. And I'm glad to hear that I actually didn't know that until you just said it. I'm really glad to hear he got a front office job with the Nationals. That's really cool. So good for Baby Shark. That's awesome to hear. As far as the Colorado series goes, yeah, Colorado, I feel like if they were in any other division other than the NL West, which is really tough, I think every team in the NL West is over 500 still at this point. So right now it's the toughest, one of the toughest, most competitive divisions in all baseball. So if you put Colorado in pretty much any other division, they might be first, second place team. So this is a decent Colorado side. The first game, like you said, an offensive explosion at Coors Field. I will say, you know, Juan Soto will probably not only make the All-Star team, he'll probably be a starter on the All-Star team. But I think they really got to consider putting Josh Bell on the All-Star team with the way he started the season. I think he's hitting like 340, 350 still at this point. I mean, Bell has been an absolute monster for this team, and he just continued it in this Colorado series. So good offense from the Nats in this series, from Soto, from Bell. And other guys as well. But again, the pitching lets them down. Patrick Corbin, I mean, you and I talked about it last week, CP3. I mean, he's been really bad this season. And it just continued in the middle game of the series. He's now 0-5 with a 7 ERA. I mean, this is a guy who was a big part of that World Series team, and he's been really, really not good this season. He's absolutely got to turn it around for the Nationals to have any success. But yeah, overall thoughts on the series, good hitting, but just the pitching wasn't there for the Nats at all, both starting and bullpen.
Yeah, just got an update. Verlander was on a no hit bid versus the Twins in the seventh inning for the Astros, and the Nats are in the bottom of the ninth with one man out, one man on, with Yadier Hernandez at the plate. It's 0-2. He's a little over-anxious. That's the one thing about the Nats right now at the plate that's really frustrating me. They're over-anxious. They're trying to do too much. You can tell, you know, swinging at first pitches, you know, not taking the time at the plate. When you got a guy on the ropes, you know, he's walked a couple of guys and the next guy comes up. Instead of seeing what he's got, he's swinging the first pitch and popping out and ending the threat or hitting it to a double play ball. So I just need them to, you know, calm down and take a deep breath. I feel like they're trying to force things, trying to get things back on the right track. And hopefully they can pull off, but they got a man on, you know. Get another man on and we in business. It's a high pitch. So it's 1-2. That was 100 miles an hour by DA. So we'll see if Hernandez can get on and get Franco to the plate to see if we can make this a more interesting game. Let's finish up the recap of last week. They finished up the week with the three-game series versus the Los Angeles Angels. This one didn't start out as well as Colorado. They unfortunately got shut out 3-0 in the first game. Jonathan Diaz earned the victory for the Angels. And I forgot to put his victory count. That's my bad. He went 5 innings, giving up 3 hits, no runs, and 4 strikeouts and 4 walks. Joan Andone took the loss. That drops him to 1-5. He went 5 innings, giving up 3 hits, 3 runs, 6 Ks with 4 walks. And last name, the places. I might even try the first name. Earned his 7th save of the season. He went 1 inning, giving up no hits, no runs with a strikeout, and no walks. It was a shutout, so there was no Nets highlights. And looks like, unfortunately, the Nets hit into a double play to end the threat and lose the first game of the series to the Mets 4-2. Mets had 4 runs, 8 hits, no errors. Nets had 2 runs, 8 hits, and 2 errors. And I believe whenever they have an error in the game, they're they're 0-13. So when they play clean, they have a better chance of winning. When they commit an error, it's pretty much a done deal. They haven't got it together enough to recover from a, you know, costly mistake that's giving runs or giving extra outs to the other team. The lone victory of the game of the series against the Angels was a gem pitched by Josiah Gray, the lone bright spot on the pitching staff. That puts him to 4-2. He went 5 1/3, giving him 5 hits, 3 runs, 3 strikeouts, and 2 walks. I say it was a gem because he was in a lot of high leverage situations in the 5 minutes he was in there with the Angels. Potent lineup, and he was able to, you know, get out of there pretty much unscathed, only giving up 3 runs in the Nets, you know, or getting some runs on the board to give him support. Michael Lorenzen took the loss. That drops him to 3-2. He went 4 2/3, giving up 5 hits, 5 runs, 7 strikeouts, and 2 walks. Josh Bell got the score going in the top of the first with a solo home run. Yadier Hernandez in the top of the second had a solo home run. And at the top of the fourth, Michael Franco had a 2-run RBI single in the top of the fourth to account for the Nats' runs. And it looks like Toronto just took the series lead against Tampa Bay. I think I just saw it come across that Toronto beat Tampa Bay. So I know Robbie will probably have an update before we go into basketball. And the last game of the weekend series was a heartbreaking loss with a blown save. The first one by Tanner Rainey this season. But Jamie Barea earned the victory. He put him at 1-0. He went 2 innings, gave up no hits, no runs, and 2 strikeouts, and no walks. Tanner Rainey took the loss. That put him at 0-1. He went 2/3 of an inning, giving up 3 hits, 3 runs, 2 strikeouts, and 1 walk. Top of the third, Soto had a fielder's choice. They gave the Nats the lead. Top of the sixth, Lane Thomas had a sacrifice fly. And Escobar had an RBI single. The top of the seventh, Josh Bell had an RBI single. The Nats were up pretty comfortable. I believe it was 4-0, and the Angels got 2 runs, I believe, in the bottom of the seventh. And unfortunately, Tanner Rainey came in to close the game. And unfortunately, couldn't get the job done against 3 of the best hitters in the league. I can't be mad because they pretty much kept Mike Trout and Ohtani quiet and Rendon quiet for the whole series. And unfortunately, they got the hits when they needed them. Trout got on. Ohtani got on. And Rendon, well, Ohtani tied the game with the RBI double, and Rendon won the game with the RBI single, scoring Ohtani for second to give the Nets a 2-4 week, losing the series and coming back home to face the division lead Mets, and unfortunately losing the first game of this series tonight, 4-2 at home. Brian, how did you like that matchup against the Angels, even though it was a series loss? They played them tough. They pretty much shut down the heart of their lineup, you know. But like I said, at the time when they counted, they couldn't get it, you know, all the way done. But it was definitely, like I said, they got some offense. They, you know, had some consistency, but still couldn't, you know, get the job done when needed because of, you know, a bullpen issue or an early pitching issue from the starters. So what did you take away from this series with the Angels?
Yeah, the Angels, there's something, it feels kind of different with the Angels this year. I don't know what it is, but they feel like, you know, they're like putting it all together. They're having like, they're off to a really great start this season. And I feel like that was kind of personified in the Sunday comeback. I'm sure that really hurt for Nats fans to not only lose a game like that, or you have a lead in the ninth inning, but to give up the game-winning hit to a former Nat and Anthony Rendon, who was such a huge part of this team for so many years. I'm sure that stung. You're right. The Nats actually did a pretty good job of holding Mike Trout and Ohtani and all the great Angels bats in this series for most of it. They did a pretty good job. They out-hit the Angels in this series, but until – and then that last inning, it just kind of all came apart. You can only shut them down for so long. And, I mean, Ohtani is just freaking incredible. I mean, what he's doing right now is just – I mean, he could very well win the MVP again this season. He's – the way he's a dual player. I watched the highlights of their game last night. He had two home runs, including a grand slam against the Rays. I mean, he's just an absolute beast. And Mike Trout is unbelievable too. So this is a good Angels team. There's really no shame in losing two out of three to them, but I'm sure you have to be frustrated, especially because the last game was so winnable. And like I said, to give up the hit to Rendon, I mean, I can't speak for Nats fans because I'm not a Nats fan, but I'm sure that absolutely sucks. Somebody who, like I said, big, big part of this team for a long, long time. And I'm sure it was weird for him, too, to get that hit. I couldn't have been comfortable all around.
Yeah, he was quiet all weekend pretty much. And I kind of blame myself, because I was in here watching the game, and I knew they would have it on MLB Network. You know, I hear the comments. I don't really like the commentators that they have. I miss FP Santangelo. I know about the controversy or whatever, but I miss FP, and Bob Carpenter wasn't on. So I flipped the channel to MLB Network just to hear, you know, when he got Trout, you know, he didn't give up any damage to Trout. So I was like, okay, I want to hear the call of some MLB guys. And that was my crucial mistake, Brian. Once I turned the channel, I messed with the baseball guys, and they made – I felt partially responsible for that loss. I felt like I
jinxed
got,
it.
Yeah,
jinxed
I felt it. Like I got part of the blown save for Tanner Rainey. So my MLB career, I got half a save – I mean, half a blown save on my record, man. it did hurt. It was a gut punch to get it by Tony Two-Bags. And that was one of my, you know, favorite players when he was here. Hated to see him go. He's been struggling a little bit in L.A., so I don't know. Franco's been playing well at third, so I don't see the Nats making a move for him, but I would love to see him back in the Nats uniform.
Yeah, definitely.
Let's look at the upcoming week. Right now, the Nats are currently now 10-21. They have a three-game series with the Mets this week. Tomorrow is a 7 o'clock start. Thursday is a 1 o'clock start. And then the Houston Astros, Brian's favorite team.
Yes. This is just Brian hate week at Nats Park. The Mets, the Astros, they're just bringing in all the teams I just absolutely hate.
And his favorite manager, Dusty Baker, is making his first trip back to Nats Park, and Astros, their first trip back here since the World Series. Friday is a 7 o'clock start. Saturday is a 7 o'clock start. And Sunday is a 1:35 start. So hopefully the Nats can – get at least 500 this week. They had a chance to at least hit 500 last week. And, unfortunately, a walk-off for the Angels ended that. But I'm hoping they can at least be 500 because, you know, I don't want to be looking at a 90-100 loss season again. I remember those days. I don't want to go back there. So what do you think our chances are of getting a 500 record this week against those two teams, Brian?
Yeah, this is going to be a very tough week for the Nats. I mean, like you said, they've already lost the first game tonight. Mets are in first place in the NL East. They're off to an incredible start. This, like I talked about the Angels, how this kind of feels like a different Angels team. Well, this feels like a very, very different Mets team. This is not the Mets you and I grew up with that suck. This is a different Mets team. They look really good this season. And I don't know that they almost feel like they're on a mission this year as well. So it's going to be tough against the Mets. Plus they've also already handled the Nats already. The only other time they played the season in the 4-game series at Nats Park to open the season, the Mets won 3 out of 4. So we'll see. That's going to be tough. And the Astros, as I call them, are red hot right now. As much as I hate to say it, they've won 7 games in a row. They are on their way to winning their 8th straight tonight. Like you said, Justin Verlander is actually currently throwing a no-hitter in Minnesota against the Twins. So we'll see if he's able to complete that tonight. Verlander's still in the game, it looks like. So we'll see if Verlander's able to complete the no-hitter tonight. The only thing keeping the Astros out of first place in their division is the Angels, who have gotten off to as equally as impressive a start. But it's going to be a real – I think it could be a real dogfight between the Angels and the Astros the rest of the way in that division. Carol, this is going to be a tough week for the Nats. It's an exciting week for sure. I mean, these are two of the best teams in the game right now, and it's a 2019 World Series rematch. There's a lot of reasons if you want to go out to the ballpark to go out to the ballpark this week, but I don't know. I think it's going to be a tough one for the Nats. Two very good teams coming to town.
All right. Well, I appreciate that synopsis. You know, I'm not an AL guy, so I didn't know that Astros were heating up that well. I know Dusty Baker just won his 2000th game as a manager, so I know well that they were playing that well. But yeah, like it's going to be another long week for the Nats as a Nats fan. At least I got Capitals hockey to keep me occupied on, you know, keep me on the high level. But as Brian, I appreciate you helping me break down the MLB. And did you want to have any American League shout outs or anything you want to talk about other than the Yankees? You know, got to get some AL talk on.
No, I'll just say I hope the Yankees are now down 5-3 in their game tonight. So hopefully they're able to make a comeback. It's the 8th inning in that one against Toronto. It's been a very tense, tight game tonight. The umpires threw out one of the Blue Jay pitchers for throwing at one of the Yankees. They thought it was intentional. So there's been a lot of drama tonight at the Yankees game. So hopefully Yankees are able to come back and pull it off. But I don't really have too much to add. It's been another good week in baseball. And just, you know, good luck to the Nats. It's gonna be a difficult week for sure, but we'll see how they get through it.
All right, I'm glad you mentioned something about the umpires. I jogged my memory.
They suck. Something.
Yeah, I agree. I have no argument on it.
Had enough.
I saw something with, I don't know what team it was, but apparently their starting catcher was already injured, and the backup catcher got thrown out from the dugout apparently because he was chirping at the umpire, and a position player that hadn't played catcher since like the minors had to go in as a catcher, and he gave it like 7 runs in the first inning.
Yeah, I think that was the Pirates. I think I heard about that too.
Yeah, it was something. We got to, hey, Brian, we've already talked about electronic strike zone and how I feel like that would help the game speed it up, get a consistent strike zone. But these umpires are really starting to get on my nerves, thinking that they're bigger than the game, thinking they're getting thrown up or they can't get talked to or talked about like they're perfect. Now, this situation right here where it really affects the outcome of a game, when you're throwing out a player just because he might have disagreed with you, or maybe he didn't shut up from the dugout, but you know the situation. So now you're handicapping a team because you want to be a dick and you feel like somebody's showing you up because you're the almighty home plate umpire and everybody's the 20,000, 30,000 fans are coming there to see you call a game, not to see these players play on the field. When is this going to come to an end? You're the baseball guy. You know, you've been probably watching baseball long. When does the frustration get to you when you're ready to start a petition to get these damn umpires out the game and just get to an electronic strike zone and just call it a day?
It's this year. I don't know what it is, but it feels like the umpires this year are just like, it feels like they feel like everybody's come to see them, and we're seeing it more and more. And like the last week there was this crazy incident with Madison Bumgarner and the umpire was like checking his hand really closely, and Bumgarner got pissed and Bumgarner got thrown out of the game. There's so many quick triggers by umpires. I thought, for example, the one in the Yankee game tonight, even though it was a Blue Jay getting ejected, I was like, damn, that is a really quick trigger. I don't know why. Like, I didn't think it was intentional at all. And so it just feels like these guys are here. They feel like all the eyes are on them, so they got to do something big and great. It's happening. It's an epidemic, man. I don't know. I've had enough of it, to be honest. This is the first year I've like really been fed up with the umpire, I don't know what they can do, like as far as like robot umpires or anything like that, but the quick triggers and everything, all the constant ejections, they got chill. It's too much.
I agree, man. Something has to be done. I didn't just have to see these umpires or something, man, because they're getting outrageous with some of these, you know, throwing these players out and, you know, changing the outcome of the game because, you know, like you said, everybody's coming to see them call the game, not to see the players play the game. It's starting to really get on my nerves.
Agreed.
All right, well,
Carol, I wanted to talk a little bit of Mystics before I get into the NBA with Brian. So I wanted to talk to you about that because the Mystics won a huge game tonight, and they're the first team in the WNBA to actually get to 3 wins. I know it's still early in their season, but they are currently undefeated. They got a win over Vegas tonight. It was 76-89. It was actually televised. I was watching it before the game. They won their season opener against Indiana, 84-70. They won the second game at Minnesota. That was a 78-66 lead. And then again, this Vegas, they won 89-76. They've got 2 more games upcoming, one against Dallas on Friday here, and then one at Dallas next Tuesday. So we'll only have 1 more game to break down next week. But Carol, what are your thoughts on the Mystics team to start the WNBA season?
Yeah, it's definitely a good start for them. I've been trying to watch them closely. I think I watched the first game, but I haven't had a chance to watch any other ones. But it's good to see them get off to a good start and see if they can get back to that championship form. I haven't even really looked at the roster to see if they still have, you know, some of them. They still have Elena Deladon and some of the players that was on that championship team. But, yeah, we definitely want to start getting more into the Mystics coverage.
Deladon had 19 points tonight. On 15, Atkins had – Ariel Atkins had 13. We got some players that I've definitely seen on the roster before. So, yeah, we'll break it down more. I just wanted to mention it because I got to watch part of that game earlier, and they looked good, scoring 89 points. That was my thought on that. Any other thoughts, Carol, on – I know I wanted to also just quickly give a scoring update. Toronto, right after we were talking about them, were able to go up by 1 again. Remember, Tampa Bay had tied it when I last mentioned it earlier in the show. So Tampa Bay with an Austin Matthews goal actually took the lead in that game and was able to hold on for that victory. So they now have a 3-2 lead in that series heading back to Tampa Bay for game 6. Again, we talked about earlier, Hurricanes beat the Bruins 5-1. Kings are beating the Oilers 1-0. And the Wild are beating the Blues 2-1. Right now. But Carol, any final thoughts on any of that before we switch into NBA talk?
No, I was actually just flipped it to the Phoenix-Dallas game. First quarter is over. Dallas is up 26-24, and that's a good segue for you guys to get into your NBA talk, and I'll go ahead and step back and let you guys break that down.
All right, sounds good. Appreciate you, Carol. And I even had a Mystics graphic that I didn't even put up. Well, that's too bad. Let me just put up the playoff one real quick that's the thing that I always forget to do. So tonight, let me actually share my screen real fast and then we can have some up on screen real quick. Safari. And let's talk about this Heat series first since it was tonight. But we can talk about hold on. Sorry. Should I fix something here? Dang it. I hate when that happens. Hold on. Sorry, my screen went out. Sorry, I just have to really quickly add another source.
It's all good.
Brian, while I do that, why don't you talk about the 76ers Heat, a game that was tonight, which the Heat were leading 120-85.
Just on this series overall, the first two games, the Sixers did not have Joel Embiid. And Miami, I believe, won the first two games fairly easily in the series. They weren't really close. And I thought this was going to be a short series. No disrespect to the Sixers players, but I just don't really trust Doc Rivers, their coach, in a big spot like this. But and I wasn't sure if Embiid was actually going to come back in the series. He was dealing with a concussion. I believe he also had a fractured orbital bone as well. But he was able to come back in game three. Game three was a pretty low scoring game. But the Sixers still won by 20. I feel like having Embiid and having his presence on the court really helped in that game. You could tell the crowd was into it. Embiid was wearing a special mask as well. And the Sixers were able to win that game. And then they were able to even up the series in game four. James Harden has been really criticized a lot in these playoffs for not really playing up to his potential, but he had a huge, huge game for the Sixers. He had 31 points, and they were able to even the series up. But tonight, total team effort from Miami down in South Beach, a real dominating performance. I watched a good portion of this game, and it was never really close from the start. Miami pretty much dominated from start to finish. Got a 120-85 victory tonight. Just a really nice team effort. I'm looking at the box score right now for the Heat. All five starters scored in double figures. Jimmy led the way with 23 points for them. Bam Adebayo had 12 points. Struss had 19 points as well. He's been a nice little player for the Heat. And so now they have a chance to eliminate the Sixers in game six. Like I said, I don't really believe in Doc Rivers as a head coach, especially in the playoffs. So I kind of like the Heat's chances. I much rather trust Eric Spoelstra in the spot than Doc Rivers for sure. So I think personally, the Heat are probably going to close this out in six games, if I had to guess.
Yeah. All right. I think I finally got it up and working again. Sorry about that.
Yeah, I see it now.
All right. So let's just talk about the series for just a second. Miami now leads 3-2. 76ers have played well at home. What are your thoughts going forward on the game six on Thursday and a game seven, if necessary, on Sunday?
I mean, like I just said, I really do not trust Doc Rivers in this spot. I've seen him lose too many playoffs. The only ring he has was when he had three iconic Celtics players in their prime still. So I just don't trust Doc Rivers in the spot, but I do trust Eric Spoelstra in the Heat. And I think they're going to close it out in game six on Thursday.
All right. Let's get into some of these other series real quick. I'm going to pull it up this far because it wasn't working before. But anyway, so this is the Dallas Mavericks against the Suns right now. It's a very close game. Right on my screen, the Mavericks are up 28-25. I see here Google is not quite as up to date. So the series right now is tied 2-2. It started off with the Suns taking game one and two in Phoenix, and the Mavericks taking games three and then four. And so this is game five here back at Phoenix. What are your thoughts on this series?
Yeah, this has been a good series so far. The home team has won every game so far. Luka Doncic is, I mean, we all know how great Luka Doncic is, but his supporting cast, I think, has been pretty good in this series as well, especially in the wins for the Dallas Mavericks. Just looking at game four, yeah, Luka led the way for them with 26 points, but Dorian Finney-Smith also had a huge performance for the Mavs in that game, especially with some big buckets down the stretch. He had 24 points in game four for the Mavericks. They also got, even Frank Ntilikina is playing some big minutes for this team. Dallas has been kind of surprising. If they can steal, I'm not expecting it, but if they can steal game five tonight in Phoenix, I think they can definitely close out the series. But, you know, Phoenix is a really good team for sure. They have a really great home court advantage. They won the first two games relatively easily on their home court, especially the second game. They won by 20 points, 129-109. And Devin Booker has been great all series for the Suns. This has been really fun. I could see the series on. I could personally see this. It's been a good series to watch. I could see the series going seven. They're going to need – but I think Dallas is really, at the end of the day, they're going to need a superhuman effort from Luka to overcome this Suns team. This is just a really good Sunstein. There's been some tense moments in the series as well. Chris Paul was awful in game four of the series. One of the worst playoff games, one of the worst games, period, of Chris Paul's career. For the Sun, actually, it was game three. Game four. Chris Paul was terrible. He also had a moment with some fans. Some fans apparently were shoving, from what I've heard, they were shoving his wife and his mother. And Chris Paul was pretty heated about that. I mean, I kind of understand. You kind of understand that. But he needs to start living up to his potential a bit in this series. He needs to start having some big games for the Suns to get through, because what happened in game four with him just won't cut it the rest of the way. But this has been a good series so far.
This is a crazy play. I don't know if you're watching this live game, but Bertans goes to the hall. He gets fouled hard, but there was a player that ran out to try to stop him and got injured on that play too.
Replay.
Yeah. So they're now reviewing this play. I'm going to be interested to see. So they said there was no flagrant foul. Because Crowder goes and
I don't think that's flagrant.
But I just, there was a chance for two different players to get injured on that play. It was just
kind
of a crazy play. Up 30-28. It's just weird to see Bertans as part of it, since he was, part of our team.
And credit, I got to give credit to Bertans and Dinwiddie. They've both been playing all right for the Mavericks in this series. That's nice to see, I guess, if you're a Wizards fan. I think that trade's going to work out well for both teams.
Right. All right. Let's talk about some of these other series real quick. I'm going to go out of this and go. So then we're going to talk about the Bucks versus the Celtics series. That is tied. The Bucks won the first game 101-89. Game two, the Celtics came back and won in Boston 109-86. Milwaukee won first game in Milwaukee 103-101, a very close game. But then the Celtics won yesterday, a 116-108 victory to tie the series at two. So that both teams split, at home. And again, this game is going to be in Boston tomorrow at 7. And so it's game five. Game six would be Friday to be determined. And if necessary, game seven would be on Sunday. Brian, what are your thoughts on this series?
This has been a great series. I think I've maintained from the start that whoever wins this series, I think will ultimately win the Eastern Conference and play in the NBA Finals. This series has been a lot of fun from the start. These are two really good teams. That game three in particular, that the Bucks won by 2 points, was really close and really tight to the end. Jason Tatum had a terrible, terrible performance for the Celtics in that game. Really cost them in that game. He was 4 of 19 from the field. He was 0 of 6 from three. Jaylen Brown was 1 of 5 from three. They needed to get more from those two players. They want any chance to win. Giannis was amazing once again. He had 42 points from the Bucks. If the Celtics can't find a way to stop Giannis, I don't see any way they can to win the series, because he's just that good. I mean, he's an incredible player. He's right now, in my opinion, the face of the NBA. And then last night's game was also really good. Came down to the wire as well. Al Horford, I got to give credit to Al Horford for the Celtics, had probably the best game. Maybe not from a pure statistical standpoint, but from a pure clutch standpoint, this was probably one of the best games of Al Horford's career. There was a moment late in the game where he got dunked on by Giannis Antetokounmpo, and there was this look in Al Horford's face. He was like, okay, I see how it's going to be. And from that moment on, Al Horford really turned it on for the Celtics. You see it right now on the screen. He had 30 points, several huge, huge, huge buckets for the Celtics down the stretch in this game. And they were able to win 116-108 to even the series up. This has been a great series. I think the series probably going 7, in my opinion. It reminds me a lot of last year's series between the Nets and the Bucks, where same thing, I felt like the winner of that series, whoever did win it, was going to win the East. And that's kind of how I feel this year. But I really still think Milwaukee will find a way to take it. This has been a really, really good series so far, and I'm really excited for the game tomorrow night. It's gonna be really fun.
That's awesome. All right, let's get into the last series real quickly. The Golden State Warriors are up 3-1, but this is how it happened. The Warriors won their first game by 1 point, 117 to 116. Talked about that one last week. And then the Grizzlies came back and won game two, 106 to 101. It switches to Golden State. Golden State wins 142 to 112 on Saturday. And then yesterday they won a much closer game, 101 to 98. Game number five is tomorrow at 9:30. Game six is Friday, time to be determined. And game seven, if necessary, would be actually during our podcast next week on Monday. That could be very exciting if it does go seven. Brian, what are your thoughts on this series?
I thought this was going to be a great series, especially after that first game. I was on here last week and I said that the first game was probably the best game I've watched in the playoffs so far. Maybe it's been overtaken by the Celtics-Bucks game three at this point, but that first game was really great. But and the Grizzlies were able to even it up. That second game is where, even though the Grizzlies were able to win that game, I feel like that's where things kind of changed, because that's where Dylan Brooks got ejected very early in that game, and he got suspended for game three for the Grizzlies on a very, very hard foul on Gary Payton, who's still out for he's out for probably the rest of the playoffs for the Warriors. And I feel like the Warriors almost were able to rally around that and win these next two games at their home arena. You see the dominating effort in game three. They won by 30 points, 142 to 112 in that game. A really dominating effort. And last night's game was very exciting. The Grizzlies actually led for a good portion of last night's game. I should mention a couple things about last night's game. One, Ja Morant suffered an injury in game three, and he was out for game four. It's since been revealed he's going to be out for the rest of the playoffs, which really sucks because Ja Morant is a great player and one of the young faces of this league. You don't want to see him have his season end like that. And also for the Warriors, Steve Kerr, their coach, was also out for game four because he was placed into the COVID protocol. So their backup or their assistant head coach, Mike Brown, had to coach this game for the Warriors. So hopefully Steve Kerr gets well soon.
Nice that they have a NBA coach as their backup, though. Right. Somebody who's done it for so long.
Mike Brown was already – it's kind of funny. That day he was appointed as the head coach of the Sacramento Kings. So it's crazy how they could just, like, plug in another NBA head coach to coach their team. So that's a really nice luxury the Warriors have. But, this was a good game, this game four. I watched a good portion of it. The Grizzlies did lead for a lot of the game, but the Warriors were just clutched down the stretch. You're looking at the numbers here. Steph, amazing, 32 points. And, some huge threes for the Warriors. And I think they're with Ja Morant being out, the Grizzlies actually did have a very good record this season without Ja Morant. Which is kind of funny because he's their best player by far, but they actually played very well without him in the regular season. But I think that's just going to be a bridge too far in the postseason.
Pretty well in this game too. It only lose by 3 points.
I know. Yeah, it's weird how they're able to.
And the Warriors had to outscore them by 10 in the fourth to get that victory. I mean,
I could see Memphis maybe pushing this to six, but to ask them to win the series against this Golden State team that's been there before, has been experienced in these playoff situations, I think that just might be too much to ask.
Yeah, for sure. Well, it's an exciting time of year. It's cool to see how these series have been. I'm happy you've been able to break it down. I've been watching a lot more of the hockey series. It's hard to watch both. I'm really excited that you and the team have been able to break down these NBA series so far. I know that next week you might not be on the show, but I'm sure we'll get one of the other guys to do it. Or if not, I'll just go through and run through the scores and how the series turned out and just let people know what's coming up next week. But Brian, I did want to mention, I'm going to end the screen share here. And I got to fix one little thing. Okay. I wanted to talk about DC United for just a second, because I was happy to see that they did get a big victory yesterday. I think it was, right? Yeah. is Houston a Dynamo game?
Yep, on Saturday.
Saturday, right. I'm sorry. Yep. It's been a week. All right, yeah, Saturday. But it was a good win. And is it Fountunas? How do you pronounce his name?
Yeah, it's they call him Taxi. His name, Aaron Judge, I think just hit a walk-off home run. Yes. Sorry, nice. I'm sorry.
No, that's good. I'm happy you can be excited. That,
hell we, yes. I'm sorry.
We like breaking news. You don't have to be sorry. You can be excited for your team.
Oh, yes. So, that was awesome. Oh, man.
I don't usually get live reactions of people. I don't get live reactions to people getting walk-off home runs, so that's kind of cool.
That was awesome. Hell yes. All right.
I'll give a quick little scoring update. To reset us. Dallas is up 38-36 right now, 5:57 in the second quarter. LA is up 1-0 over Edmonton. I finally turned on my ESPN Plus app because my cable wasn't working. I was like, well, I'm going to still watch that game. So what was the final score in the Yankees game?
Aaron Judge just hit a walk-off 3-run home run to give the Yankees a 6-5 win.
Oh, wow. 6-5. So you needed all those runs.
Yes,
so,
sir. Awesome. Yeah, awesome. Yeah. Awesome moment against the Blue Jays. Hell yes. Oh, yes.
Nice. The Blue Jays, Toronto got a win in hockey, which I'm sure they're much more happy about than they care about their baseball.
They can have. So,
exactly. all right. Well, let's go back to DC United. So yeah, he goes by Taxi.
Taxi. They call him Taxi. Taxi Fountas. Yeah.
Yes,
and he scored twice this weekend.
Yeah, 35th minute and the 43rd minute. So yes. that's two in a pretty short period of time, and the only two goals by anybody in this game.
Yep,
an exciting win for DC United, who have up and down season so far. They lost to the Columbus Crew 3-0. We talked about that one last week. And upcoming on May 14th, they play Miami CF at Miami. And that's an 8:00 game. How are they doing this year?
Miami's kind of an interesting story. They got off to a really bad start. This is their third season in MLS, I think. They have some pretty famous ownership. They're owned by David Beckham in some capacity. So they definitely have some famous ownership. But, you know, they've been a bit of an up and down story this year. They got off to a terrible start. Then they won some games in a row. Then I believe they lost two games in a row. And then they won this past weekend. So it'll be an interesting challenge. I would say they're probably at about the same level as DC United. Same plane, I would say. Kind of like a fringe, just maybe barely on the outside looking in type team. But the MLS is always tough. And it feels like a lot of teams are getting better this year. For example, like Cincinnati has gotten a lot better this year. Montreal's gotten better. Charlotte in their first year is surprising teams as well. So it could be a bit of a tough road for DC United the rest of the way. We'll see how it goes. Two other soccer stories I kind of want to mention quickly here that are both DMV related, DC related, is that one, on July 20th, DC United will be playing Bayern Munich, who are the top German team. I mean, they've won the Bundesliga 10 years in a row. They are one of the top powerhouses in all of Europe. And the fact that DC United will be playing them at Audi Field on July 20th is just awesome. I'm hoping to go to that game. That'll be really cool to see at the Audi Field. So get your tickets for that. And also, it was just announced today that my favorite soccer team, Arsenal, is coming to Baltimore this summer, just a couple days before Bayern comes to D.C. That game is July 16th. They're playing Everton at the Raven Stadium, M&T Bank Stadium, I think it's called. So I'm going to try and get to as many of those games against these top teams as I possibly can. It should be a great summer for hopefully soccer in the DC area.
That's amazing that we got two big things. There is a soccer hotbed in this area. It's frustrating because they don't exist so much on Facebook and on, you know, Twitch and stuff like that. Or, you know, there's not a lot of groups because I've joined all of them and they're pretty dead.
Shout out to my guy Christian, by the way, who was holding down the US the soccer group that he added me to. That group's awesome. Shout out to Christian.
Yeah, that is, he is awesome. He's a friend of the show. He's been on our show before as well. He's a big hockey fan. So, yeah, it's just frustrating because I wish that we could have more of a United following and more of a soccer following, because I think it's a really cool sport. I used to coach it, help EJ coach it. And, you know, I've always enjoyed talking about it with Brian. And I still have yet to get to Audi Field. I need to. And it's something that I really want to do. When the kids get a little older, I am happy to say that Zach does do soccer every Saturday. It's an important part of our weekend. He does do t-ball every Sunday. So the last two segments that we just did, he's learning both of those sports. So that's kind of cool. And definitely two sports that I want to continue him to, you know in the future, minor league baseball, well as the major league ones as well. So I appreciate you for helping me break both down soccer baseball every week. And the following week for DC United, they'll actually have two games, so we'll talk about that, including one against your favorite team. So they play New York City FC on Wednesday, May 18th, and Toronto FC on Sunday, May 21st. So we'll recap how they did against Miami. If you're not, I'll just give the score. But if you are on, we can talk about that, and we talk about the New York FC game. But I always love you breaking it down. I know as the summer continues, you'll continue to talk soccer with us.
Yeah, definitely.
Brian, are you doing a show this week on your podcast? And let people know.
If I have time, I'll do an episode this week. Things are kind of busy at my job right now. We're pretty shorthanded, so I've got a lot of stuff to tend to there. But if I have the time, I'll get it done. But other than that, thanks for having me on, guys. Always a pleasure. Still fired up about what just happened in the Yankee game, so I think I'm gonna go celebrate that for the rest of my night. But I really appreciate you guys joining me. I really appreciate you guys letting me join you, I should say. But thanks, guys. I'll talk to you guys next time.
Sounds good, Brian. Appreciate it as always.
Talk to you guys later.
Go enjoy your Gatorade, man.
Yes, sir. I'm going to dump the Gatorade all over my head.
All right, bro. Take it
later, easy. Guys.
All right, later. All right, Carol, we got a lot of sports in here. We got women's basketball, which I want to give a quick little shout out, which we include in our District of merch, which people were interested in and asking me questions about the other day. It still is available on our website, sportsothp.com, as well as all the podcasts and all the different videos, including other shows that I've been on, some of our victory videos as well I've posted on there, and Carol's YouTube. You can get that from sportsothp.com. It's got a ton of great content, including highlight videos. I've got some scuba content on there. This actually, when I upload this video, Carol, to my YouTube channel, it'll be my 300th YouTube video. So that's kind of cool. I'm excited. This upcoming weekend, I'm going to be taking Zach to his very first concert, AJR. I'm super excited about that. I always film concert videos. They tend to do pretty well on my channel. They usually get about 1,000 views, which are the most viewed stuff on there. I hope that people like to see his very first concert. I'm going to document that for him. It's his favorite band. He knows every song. He's only 3 and a half, all the words. It's crazy. I'm just super excited to see that for him. And hopefully the Caps can find a way to win two of these next three games. I just want to give a quick scoring update. Phoenix is up 44-42 over Dallas, 2 minutes left in the first half. Still up 1-0 over Edmonton with about a minute left in the first period in that game. But Carol, any final thoughts before I let you go and I do my quick little post-game thing on my show?
No, as always, appreciate you guys tuning in, checking us out. We're covering everything, bringing you the best DC sports coverage around, live look-ins, updates on everything that's going on. Make sure you check out the website, sportsothp.com. Unfortunately, to my YouTube viewers, I refreshed my software and forgot to refresh my YouTube link, so now I'll have to upload the show to YouTube. So unfortunately, my YouTube viewers who I promoted for them to watch the show tonight are probably a little upset because there's nothing on my channel right now. And
that's okay. You're on Twitch live. We don't even talk about that. I'm on Twitch. I've been loving all the people coming through.
I still got to figure out that with you. We got to talk offline because, yeah, I'm totally lost with Twitch right now. So, yeah, I definitely got to.
I was thinking maybe we should start saving your VODs because if you had, it's one click and you could send it right to YouTube, which would have been easy for you. So maybe the reason alone is a backup to keep your VODs on your Twitch. But we can talk about that online.
Yeah, definitely. But so, yeah, I'll be uploading that either tonight or tomorrow. So stay tuned for that. And if you're in the market for a new used vehicle, come check me out down at Waldorf Honda, 2450 Crane Highway. New credit, no credit, bad credit. Let me get a chance to earn the business. Got a great financial team that we can build down for you. As always, check out the YouTube channel, Carol Porter III with Three Eyes. You know, I'm in the show with independent videos. I'm also playing one of the tracks that I produce for local artists, Brian Hart Submissive. Check it out. It's on all platforms, along with some of the tracks that I play from Renegade and some of the other guests that we have on At the Bar Radio on there every Sunday night around 6 o'clock, covering the entertainment, news, sports, independent music, current events, and all that good stuff. And we normally have some different types of liquors on there that we talk about and, you know, have a little fun on the show. So make sure you check us out. Appreciate y'all as always. CP3, Robbie G, live from the lab in the man cave. See you next week. DC Sports Without the Politics. It's not just a catchphrase. It's not just a motto. It's what we do. And we out. See you next week.
All right. And we're out. I'm just making sure that my recordings are all saved. That recording as well.
Recording stopped.
And I appreciate everyone for tuning in live here on Twitch. It was a really fun show. We got to talk about a lot of different sports. Obviously, I hope that the Caps can find a way. I really would love to continue a series. Right now, Toronto is winning. That would be the team we would play. It'd be interesting to see how Tampa Bay does when they come back in the next game. I expect that one to go long as well. If anybody is lurking or wants to guide the raid, this is the opportunity to do that now. Let me know. If not, I'm going to just take a quick little look here to see who's on and see who we should raid. Our friend Davey's eating a sandwich is on. I could raid him. That could be kind of cool. I don't think I've ever raided Davey before, but I'll let anybody else give their final thoughts real quickly if they have any. And but I really appreciate everyone for tuning in live on Twitch. It's always fun to do it with all you guys. All right. I think unless anyone has any thing, I'm gonna have to do the raid. We'll set it up right now. All right. I appreciate everyone for joining in, and we're going to raid over to Davey is eating a sandwich. I hope that you guys enjoy Davey as much as I do. This is a special edition of Sports on the Hill podcast, episode 270. It was a fun show. We got to have Anna and Brian on. Thanks to both of them. Thanks to Carol. That was a really awesome time. We got to talk about all the different Washington DC sports except for the Commanders. It wasn't a whole lot of Commanders news. We'll get into that when it's that season. I thank Brian for breaking down all the different sports with me, and we'll head over to Davies right now. Next week we'll be back to our normal time on Monday, hopefully recapping a series win for the Cap. Also recap all of the playoffs for all the NHL teams on all the NBA round two games as well, and how the Nats did on this very tough week that we have coming up. But I hope you guys all have a great week, and I'll talk to you soon. I hope you enjoy Davey.